Good afternoon, Web Summit. Hope everyone's having a good one. So we're here to have a chat about books, technology, what's next, what's changing, and perhaps what isn't changing. As with books, it's always a little bit of all of it. Dwight, you've got probably one of the most interesting vantage points to look on books as an industry and as a cultural product. What's your sort of state of the nation now? How fast are things changing in your world?
It's changing radically every day. I mean, as we all know, publishing is becoming consolidated. There are fewer and fewer publishing houses. But I will say the first thing that rocked my world as a literary critic working in the English language was Google and technology wiping out newspapers. Because all this, it used to be in America, a new book would come out, it would get 100 book reviews, because newspapers all over the country would review it. In Chicago, in Detroit, in Cleveland, there were small alternative weeklies, they're called, and now they're all gone. And so a new book in America might get 5 reviews, whereas only 15 years ago, maybe gotten 100.
It is that discovery stream, isn't it? The internet is supposed to be really good for the long tail, for all of that. But actually, if you're not already a name author, whether it's fiction or nonfiction, it's quite hard to get picked up now, isn't it? There's the hollow out of the media.
It's true. There's a cacophony of voices. They're all trying to rise to the top. Getting published, it's a very greasy pole to climb. Very few people manage to get published, at least by a proper publishing house in America. And, you know, it's still almost as hard as it ever was.
Yeah. Atlam, to bring you in, I mean, what you do is, a lot of what you do at the Foundation is actually about helping not just undiscovered authors get sort of found, but people to navigate the industry and to actually try and create a literary scene where it doesn't exist. You know, do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, it's interesting, the space in which I work, because of the International Literature Festival that we run, the Emirates Literature Festival. We deal with the international book community, and we invite quite a lot of international writers to Dubai. We deal with agents, publishing houses. We go to London, New York quite often, and are quite well connected internationally. At the same time, back at home, we're not quite as developed as some of the other more developed publishing markets. And so we're sort of putting in place foundational work in having distributions, clear distribution pathways for publishing houses, having data. So for example, Nielsen data is only now entering this market and connecting with, some of the entities that look after sort of the publishing industry to put information together. And without data, it's really difficult to get clear strategies in place. And so we're working off of anecdotal data, secondhand data, what we have and what we know through our festival.
Do you think there are any lessons for publishers or for authors who are dealing with the US situation where, you know, a sort of literary scene is almost dying out in reviving it? Mm-hmm. From sort of trying to build it where it perhaps wasn't there. You know, do you think there are lessons from what you do that could carry over to that context?
Yeah, it'd be interesting to see. I think, one thing that I've seen in the literature field around the world is, I was telling Dwight this earlier, I've seen more interest from agents, from publishing houses in publishing stories from our region. And I've seen more author representations, more publishing deals in narrative from around the world, which is interesting. So that's, you know, part of what I see in the future of publishing. It's very interesting. I know we're here at the Web Summit and looking at AI and sort of being the elephant in the room, what's going to happen. But I think curated content will become more and more important. So whether it's what Dwight does, which is critique books, or literature festivals that actually select these writers from around the world. I think for the general public who loves reading, I think these forums and these platforms are more and more important to sort of filter out the noise.
Cool. I promise, get to AI at some stage in the questioning. I think I'd get fired as a moderator if I didn't at a tech conference. I think first with you, Jai, I always find it quite interesting to talk about format with books. As I think 10 years ago, you know, it was fashionable to say that print books would die out. And I think that's not the consensus at all anymore, is it?
It's not consensus. The kids I meet these days, granted, I live in New York City, granted, I deal with people who are tend to be readers. New York City is a very literate town, as is Lisbon, by the way. I can't believe how good the bookstores are here. But I see this new generation who wants to embrace print. Mm-hmm. And they walk around, they hold their books, and you see people now on the subway with books. I mean, there's nothing worse than an e-reader on the subway because you don't know what anyone's reading. You know, and I love knowing what people are reading. It sort of wakes me up. But yeah, I'm optimistic about the state of print.
Yeah, I mean, I tend to find this. I do some book critic stuff in the UK. And a few years ago, publishers would try just to send you electronic proofs and PDFs. They're all back to sending the print ones out now, aren't they? I mean, you were telling me backstage, Athlan, as well about how there's the sort of book fairs that the public come to in the UAE, and there's still that print demand there as well, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I think particularly among Gen Z, we're seeing print books are becoming collectibles. You know, the older generation is sort of embracing the Kindle and it's lighter weight and you can travel with it and take it wherever you want. But I think the younger generation definitely still very attached to print. Book production is still a huge, huge business. Definitely optimistic as well.
So let's start getting into AI, but before we get into some of the obvious sort of questions on it, you sort of saying that there's issues with what data goes into an AI to train it. Mm-hmm. And of course, as it's trained on the internet, there's huge amounts of information about America and about Europe, loads of English language, mm-hmm. and then quite a lot less of some languages. And you've actually done some work to sort of help seed that, you know, where other people are trying to get their work taken out of AI. Yeah. You've been trying to get some in there, haven't you?
Yeah, I think just leveling the play field. I think a couple of years ago, I was looking at data on Arab authors online, and there really wasn't organized metadata. And I started to get into the world of Wikipedia and looking at what data was out there. And it was shocking that 3 years ago, there was only 1,500 pages on Arab authors online in the Arabic language and only about 500 in English. So it was a terrible place to start from. But we've quickly, through volunteer work, through training across universities, having wiki clubs, etc., been able to get that number up to 27,000 today. So,
I mean, 1,500 to 27,000 is a pretty good boost, right?
It really has been. And also now we're starting to see translation into other languages in English and Spanish. And once you see information in your language, you start to think, okay, that information must be relevant for me. That's why it's been translated to my language.
Yeah.
I think so. And now you're seeing Wikipedia have widgets on ChatGPT and being connected into this whole generative AI space. So I think there's a lot more work to do to make sure that information about the region in all fields is updated so that, to even get to the problem of is AI going to replace humans? If it doesn't know who we are, it's not going to get there.
And that's got to be really important for having authors and having stories from other regions and other languages represented, isn't it? If people aren't, you know, it feels like it shouldn't be on you to do it, but someone has to. If you want AIs to know those stories and recommend those people, it has to be in what it sees, doesn't it? And so there is this strange visibility problem if we're not just going to carry on promoting the same authors that have always been promoted.
Right.
So I think the least interesting aspect of AI with books is, will AI write books? So shall we deal with that quickly? You know, I know there was a panel on it earlier. So, you know, are you expecting to review at any time soon AI literary fiction?
Fuck no. I already despise AI. It's shoveling all this shit into my direction online because it knows that I like things. It knows that I like Joni Mitchell. So AI will figure out some article. Joni Mitchell, did you know her first record was filmed in a cave in Berlin? And I can tell that AI has written it. You just know. Yeah. It just has that Wikipedia generic crabwise walk tone. There's no point to it. Any books that will come out of AI, at least for the next 100 years, will be god awful. And what I fear is, though, you know, I'm a literary critic. I work for the New York Times. AI will not replace serious writing. I mean, the best writing is ineffable. It's like replacing serious wine with grape juice and sugar, you know. But what I fear is that the kind of readers who read, and there's no shame in loving a mystery before bed, but the kind of readers who gravitate towards writers who are easy to replicate, your James Patterson, who writes a book every 3 months, as if he has Keebler elves tucked away in his bathroom, you know.
Yeah.
And that kind of stuff might be replaceable by AI. And I worry about the shit that's going to be shoved down people's throats from this technology in terms of literature.
I mean, you're seeing it already on sort of the Amazon free publishing. You know, the very low quality people would churn out a title. Obviously, AI is brilliant for generating that. I actually had a play myself, though, on... I asked GPT-4, which is one of the advanced ones, if it could do me 10 plot twists for Agatha Christie-style novels. And they were dreadful. They were really predictable. Do you have anything you want to add on this sort of topic?
I think I'm contemplating deeply about this space as well. I think we're not there yet. And whether it's a big unknown, whether authors start to use AI as a co-author, whether they start to use it for some of the more sort of structural work and grammatical edits, things like that, maybe. But I think the very, very good writers are the ones that are going to be the most difficult to replace.
I've got a real interest in AI and translation. I might ask both of you to respond on this, but Alam, you first. I think there's quite an exciting potential in being able to get a relatively high quality translation to any language of pretty much any book. You know, I know as an author, it's very random what translations you get. Mm-hmm. You know, English is the only language all my books are in, and then there's some in Chinese, some in Korean, some in German, some in... And, like, the idea that you could consistently get almost any book in the language you'd prefer seems quite exciting to me. But then I also know from knowing literary translators, it's a very skilled, very subtle job.
Right.
And so is there a way to balance the potential good without sort of losing the art and the beauty of, you know, a real translation that gets the soul as well as the literal meaning?
Yeah, I think if you look at Google Translate, it's been around for how long now?
About 20 years.
It's still quite clinical, doesn't get the nuance in language at all, in my perspective, for Arabic at least, and definitely translating Arabic into English as well. So, and like you say, translation is an art on its own. You're almost rewriting the book, and there's a lot of things that you'll explain reworded, and you rewrite it to sort of give the same sentiment. It's not a word-for-word translation. Whether AI will be able to do that, I don't know. We're very far from it, I think.
As we know, sometimes as readers, we read for information, right? Mm-hmm. And if we're reading for information, this kind of translation is fantastic. It's fantastic to go find a book in a language you do not speak and get an instant translation for it.
Right.
It's amazing. If you're reading for joy, for pleasure, for nuance, for
exactly.
language, it's not very good. I assume it will get better, but I think that its biggest applications will be, let me skim this book about AI written in Arabic. That's really fascinating.
Exactly. And I think the more AI takes care of the more tedious parts of the work, we will go deeper and deeper into the human brilliance side, which is the creativity, the personal experiences, and the things that we observe as human beings that nobody else can.
I think it will be kind of fascinating to see how it goes. As one of the stranger foreign publishing decisions of my career was I did a book of jokes about pop songs. It's essentially fact-checking pop songs, you know. Yeah. How many roads must a man walk down? What wouldn't Meatloaf do? And it got picked up by a German publisher. And English humor and German humor famously do not translate well. And so this poor translator had to try and do 200 pages of stupid jokes, most of which didn't work in a German context. So,
do you use AI in your own writing at all yet? For research?
Not really. I sometimes like it to throw out prompts or throw out ideas.
Right.
I think partly I play with it because I'm a technology journalist and I cover it. I'll ask it to do the best version of an argument against mine. I have dropped in a column that I've written and gone, you know, critique this. You know, what's the three worst parts of this piece? And it lets me, like, test, okay, what might an editor say? Why might an editor say this piece is terrible? But also, you know, is there a glaring flaw that even an AI can spot in my argument? I find that useful.
Yeah. That's a very good idea. I've never thought of that before. Mm-hmm. AI always mocks me because if I ask it to write an article in the style of my own writing tends to be a lot of similes and metaphors and food imagery, and it mocks me. It's all this food imagery, you know. This book is like a box of chocolate, you know, as Dwight Garner would say. I mean, not quite that bad. But it never occurred to me to use it to push against your own writing. It's a good idea.
Yeah, it's things like that that's quite fun for. It's like having a fairly intelligent sort of editor or critic that can give you feedback in about 15, 20 seconds.
Right.
Have you been playing with it much at all for anything that you guys do?
Yeah, a little bit. You know, things like give me a nutritious food diet or, you know, explain like a general topic that I'm not very familiar with briefly in 100 words or things like that. I think playing around with it definitely got a lot of perks. I think the space that we're not sure about is maybe more of the creative space. Although I was speaking to a couple of people here in the design space recently, and they, you know, it's actually very scary what's going on. You can give, I think people in the creative space are going to become more and more sort of prompt engineers. The better you know how to tell AI what to do, what to correct, and better direct it to what you need, then your job will still be relevant because it still does need that excellent director.
Yeah.
But
I mean,
there
may be some
scary
concerns for cover jacket designers and for book illustrators and people like that.
Right.
A question for you, Dwight. One thought that occurs to me is that there's a lot of potential for AI to help accessibility of books, whether that's for younger readers or whether that's for sort of people who have difficulties with sort of complex books, etc. You could actually have something that could scale down the length or the complexity of a book sort of automatically. But I imagine that raises all sorts of issues around copyright, ownership, you know, legitimacy, etc. Now, I imagine you'd be quite against an easy reader version of Ulysses, but, you know, is there something to this?
Yeah.
Maybe.
You look horrified.
If I were, perhaps it would be useful for me if there was a book that I had not read, and I wanted to read a 10-page synopsis, or a 100-page synopsis, even, of Ulysses, or just to understand what Joyce is going for, or you know, the Bible, or just to have a really worked down version of it. I think there's some usefulness in that. So yeah, I could see doing that, and I could even see as a literary critic saying, "Describe for me Moby Dick in 10 pages." You know, that's kind of interesting to see what we'll come up with. So I do think there's applications, and to be honest, I have used it in that way. I've sort of said to it, "If there's an international writer whom I've never read, explain this writer to me and who his or her influences are and tell me about them," and it is not terrible.
Yeah, it's sort of that question of the greater good, because we have a big copyright issue in the Arab world in that it's very difficult to regulate it in different countries, and we know that there is millions and millions of downloads of certain books online for free. And on the one hand, you desperately want to regulate that for the industry, but on the other hand, how many people will lose access to good literature? It's a difficult decision to make.
It is quite a hard balancing act, isn't it? I mean, you know, there's related contention in this in that a lot of generative AIs have pulled up full books. One of my books has been used in training data of at least one model. You don't get told it's that someone got a leak and found out. And
are you happy? I would
notified
be.
It. I honestly don't know. I feel a little bit annoyed that all of that work that I put in to find out all the stuff in the book is just there and useful to someone else and will be regurgitated with nothing to me.
Well, see, as a reader, I'm annoyed that you're annoyed because I like it that AI is sweeping up the smart people and not just sweeping up the lesser stuff. So I like it that it's grabbing the best there is, at least. I mean, and not to plagiarize you.
Yeah.
I just mean just to take the strength of your words and ideas and make them available to...
But generally, as an author, you get compensated if your work gets used. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not very much, but I get about twice a year, I get a check for about £60 for photocopying of my books in schools and universities in the UK. Mm-hmm. Like, if you photocopy, you do it. I get a separate little check for when people borrow it at the library. So, yeah, do, by the way, feel free to borrow books from libraries. That's supporting authors. Just don't buy them from charity shops. That's not. I should stress that's a joke. Please do support charities. But this feels like there's value. I would rather books are included, but I do feel like even if it's another silly £30 small check, mm-hmm. I do feel like we should get something for it if my hard work's going in there.
But do you feel that AI is really putting your work out in a way that would prevent someone from buying your book? I don't see it that way. Do you?
I think probably not, but it is odd. It does bother me, and I can't put a finger on a loss, which is a strange place to be in.
I don't know. I see these great novelists, Jonathan Franzen, saying, I'm so upset. But I'm glad that AI at least is taking the syntax and the, you know, from great people. It makes me happy somehow. I don't want them to try to resell it or regurgitate it or plagiarize it. But if it's making the language of the entire, you know, of civilization brighter, I like that, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Am I crazy?
I suppose that's an argument for saying it's helping make sure that books and the ideas in books contributes to the next wave of knowledge, which I think we would want to happen, wouldn't we?
Yeah.
So our time's running out, so I'm going to ask each of you for what your biggest worry is for the books as an industry in the next 5 years and what your biggest sort of hope or biggest opportunity is.
Ella?
Yeah, it's a very big question. We're still getting our head around what all this means. It's quite a lot of disruption in the industry right now, so it's going to change fundamentally how things work. You know, with books going on Spotify right now, a lot of literary agents and authors were worried about that. They weren't consulted by the publishers who have put that forward and what that means financially for them, who gets the biggest gain. I think for me, it's all still a big question. I'm not sure about all the answers, really. We'll watch the space and see.
My big fear, and it's been my fear for a while, is that we're such a culture, in English at any rate, of writers. There's so many writers. I worry about there not being enough readers. You know, I mean, everyone I meet, it's like you never meet a poet, or you never meet a reader of poetry, but you meet a lot of poets. You know, and I want more readers in the world. That's what my life is about. That's what I try to do in my work. And I am optimistic, though, in the end. I feel like literary culture will always be small to a degree, because it's an intense, complicated world, but it's still out there, and it's still real, and it's still, I think, very vibrant.
So, well, thank you both so much, and thank you. You've been a wonderful audience.
Thank you.